I'm going to speak about Jakarta EE. A lot has already been said today, so it's a challenge for me to speak after all those nice people. I propose to do it in a following manner from a user perspective. So what do I mean by a user perspective? The Java ecosystem is made of vendors, open source communities, individual contributors, evangelists, organizations. Most of them have widely communicated in the context of recent changes. But there is another user, another actor, the end user of the technology. I mean the guy who does real-life projects and delivers business value with the technology. And this guy may feel lost because Java EE, the symbol of technical stability, is ongoing a major transformation. And even worse, it's the same for Java SE for different reasons. So, how to behave between naive optimism and exaggerated pessimism? This is what I propose to speak about. A few words about me. I am basically a Java user, I would say an old Java user. I spent more than 30 years in the IT and 2/3 of them with Java. I work at Worldline, an Atos Group company. We build and run digital platforms on behalf of our customers. Our business domain, initial business domain, is payment, and we have expanded our capacity to process secured electronic transactions to other domains such as e-governments, health, transport. This is the agenda of my talk. We will first start with a short retrospective. Knowing the past is essential to look into the future. We will analyze the changes that have led to cloud-native applications. We will speak more specifically about Java EE 8. I will explain why I have the feeling to be in a turbulent zone as a user. And last but not least, we will see how to prepare the future. So that's a lot to say in a short amount of time. So let's go. So this is a personal representation, deliberately simplified, of the evolution of the Java platform from J2EE to Java EE 7. First were the J2EE times, what I often call the prehistoric times, because the specifications were made in a top-down approach without considering the developer experience. And this led to extra complexity. In 2004, Rod Johnson wrote a book, a very interesting book, proposing a pragmatic and simple approach to develop J2EE applications. And this book had a huge impact on the Java community. It was the beginning of the Spring framework. It also had an indirect impact on the Java EE platform. For the first time, with Java EE 5, ease of development was really taken into consideration with JPA instead of the dreadful CMDB, annotations, convention over configuration. Another major milestone was achieved with JBoss SIM, a framework developed by Gavin King, the founder of Hibernate, which paved the way to CDI, context and dependency injection. So CDI has become the foundation of the Java EE platform. It has been introduced with Java EE 6, and it acts as a glue between the different specifications and to integrate external technologies. Java EE 7 was essentially a continuation with additional features such as batch processing, JSON processing, WebSocket. Overall, Java EE was a good balance, a good trade-off between innovation and standardization. It aimed to be the place to standardize innovation, which was right, by the way. For instance, GPA is essentially a standardization of Hibernate. Spring Batch has highly influenced JBatch. And as we have said, JBoss SIM has paved the way to CDI. In particular, Java EE was a good fit for long-term projects. This is the case in payment. In the payment domain, we need backward technical compatibility, capitalization on the technology, and also PCI compliancy and auditability with strong secure patch management. So maybe Java-E was not that innovative, but at least it was stable and a good fit for certain projects. After Java-E 7, the pace of change began to accelerate. It started with DevOps, calling for better cooperation between Dev and Ops, with good practices such as continuous deployment, infrastructure as code, NoSQL and polyglot persistency with solutions such as MongoDB and Cassandra challenging traditional SQL database, microservices exemplified by Netflix, and partially formalized by the 12 factors from Heroku. Of course, the container revolution with Docker and Kubernetes, and more recently, reactive programming in order to get better stability and scalability in the cloud. So in a few years, a new model of development emerged, what we now call cloud-native applications, typically made up of self-runnable services, call it microservices or not, with polyglot persistency and built-in monitoring, resiliency, health check, making the most of DevOps good practices and the cloud platforms. So by 2015, we can say that the gap between market expectation for cloud-native applications and Java-E had widened. So what happened to Java-E 8 in 2014 and 2016? Basically, nothing. Things restarted seriously in 2016 with two initiatives. An active group called the Java-E Guardian was set up by Reza Rehman in order to restart the specification. So they organized petitions, surveys, they made noise trying to influence Oracle. Almost at the same time, the MicroProfile project was started by a group of vendors, all of them except Oracle, in order to define an open specification for cloud-native, Java cloud-native application. At Java 1, in October, Oracle shared a new and ambitious roadmap. The objective was to renew the platform within 2 years, and things were back on track, and the community was enthusiastic again. I was there. We were all very enthusiastic. I even enrolled in the GCP, saying, OK, it has restarted, let's go. And 1 year after, Java 8 was actually released with Glassfish 5.0, its reference implementation, with the following main change: alignment with Java SE 8. As a reminder, Java SE 8 was delivered 1 year after Java E 7, so it was required to take into account optional streams, completable features, the new datetime API, and so on. HTTP2 support with Servlet 4.0, asynchronous events with CDI 2.0, a client-side reactive programming side with JAX-RS 2.1, with server-side event, JSON processing announcements with JSON patch and JSON pointer, a new specification JSONB to bind Java classes and JSON structure, and a new security specification bringing simplification and standardization. So overall, a good continuation, but nothing revolutionary. By the way, it is worth mentioning that the old java.net site has been decommissioned for the benefit of GitHub, a first step toward modern open source development. So after 20 years of relative stability, in summer 2017, we entered a turbulent zone. In 43 days, everything changed. First, mid-August, Oracle announced its intention to stop the development of Java-E Mid-September, the Eclipse Foundation was chosen to host the future of the platform. Java SE9 and Java EE8 were delivered at the same time, both being very disruptive for different reasons. And end of September, the top-level EE4G project was created. So this is a lot of change in a short amount of time. So as a user of the technology, it raises many concerns, and it's very difficult to have a clear perspective of the future in such a context. So from now on, I propose to share with you some concerns, some expectations I have in mind about this transition. So my first concern was how to succeed to the GCP. For me, until now, the GCP was the sole authority able to define Java standard for the Java technology. So when the decision was taken by Oracle, my first question was, what will make an open specification under the auspice of an open source foundation more valuable than a proprietary framework? For me, the reference was the GCP. There is no easy answer to that question, but there are good indicators. The first one is the Eclipse microprofile project, which has clearly demonstrated that an open specification can work. They started very modestly in summer 2016, based on three Java EE specification, JAX-RS, CDI, and JSON-P. I must admit, I was a bit skeptical at that time. What are they doing exactly? Okay. But they have succeeded to deliver 4 releases and 5 implementations in a few months. So this is clearly a very positive indication. A group of vendors, of competitors, have joined their effort to define an open specification. So this is a good sign for Jakarta EE and the future of Java EE. The second positive indicator is the Eclipse Foundation itself. In fact, it puts a high focus on vendor neutrality. For instance, with the GCP, the IP, the intellectual property of each specification, was the ownership of the specification leader. With Jakarta EE, from what I have understood, each specification will run as a standard open source project, ensuring no single ownership of the IP. So this is a good foundation. Another very interesting indicator is the fact that companies which were totally external to the Java EE ecosystem so far, Microsoft and Lightband, have decided to join the project. So this is a good indicator. A few words about Lightband. 4 years ago, in my company, we had the opportunity to meet Jonas Bonner and Victor Klang, the founders of the company, TypeSafe at that time, in order to see how to mix Java EE and Akascala. And at that time, it was a total no-go. It was a total mismatch. We decided to stop. Two opposite worlds. That's why I'm very happy to see Lightband entering the arena with very good proposal. We have seen James just before me, which is a positive sign. Another positive sign is that Pivotal, the owner of the Spring framework, is also interested by Jakarta EE. So I've come to a point where I've get the interest of an open specification, and I'm convinced by the legitimacy of the Eclipse Foundation. My second concern is about governance. During 20 years, the GCP has done a great job regarding governance. Each specification was managed as a JSR, Java Specification Request, with an expert group. There were clear deliverables, documentation, reference implementation, TCK, a well-defined lifecycle to promote the GSR from initiation to final release, and the overall coordination was ensured by a PMC. So this model has enabled the platform to last 20 years, but it has not been able to cope with recent pace of change. So how will that work with the Eclipse Foundation? Each specification and reference implementation will be run as an individual open source project. There are currently 39 of them. The deliverables will be the same: document, reference implementation, test compatibility kit. The overall coordination will be done by the top level E4G project, and there will be a brain, as mentioned by Kevin, the Jakarta E working group in charge of brand management, because I think it's a very important aspect, and Java E has suffered clearly from lack of brand management. We often see J2EE in resume today. J2EE is dead since more than 10 years, but the fact is that Java E was not clearly identified. It has no logo, no clear marketing. And the most important aspect of the Jakarta E working group is the specification process. As far as I know, its definition is still an ongoing process. It's still an ongoing work, and it will be decisive for the success of the platform. My third concern is about having a cloud-native platform. As we have mentioned, Java E 8 is not at the state of the art regarding cloud-native applications. Fortunately, MicroProfile has done a great job in that matter. They started very modestly, as I have explained, in September 2016, and they have delivered 4 releases, and the last one, delivered early this year, contains almost all the ingredients for cloud-native applications. So distributed tracing, security propagation, common configuration, fault tolerance, and so on. So this is clearly all the ingredients we need to make Jakarta E fully cloud-native. How can this happen? Regarding Jakarta E roadmap, 2 releases are expected this year, by the end of this year, and Glassfish 5.2 will be the first Jakarta EE 8 certified version. Am I right? No? Really? From what I have understood, Glassfish 5.1 will be Java E8 certified, and Glassfish 5.2 will be Jakarta EE certified. This is true? Okay, that is true. Okay. That means that with Glassfish 2 will mark the readiness of the new specification process. In parallel, MicroProfile has planned a 2.0 release coming soon, which will be Java E8 compliant. So my vision as a user, maybe it's a bit naive, is that by injecting MicroProfile 2.0 with Glassfish 5.2, we will have a full cloud-native platform. I hope this to happen early next year. I don't know if it's realistic, but for me, it seems possible. The third concern I had in mind was about modularity. Java E has not a good reputation in terms of modularity. There are different levels of modularity. First, modular specifications. I think that we need loosely coupled and highly consistent specification, composable at will, based on a common foundation, CDI plus a common configuration mechanism. Then we need modular API and implementations. And whether we like it or not, I think we will have to rely on GPMS, the native Java module system introduced in Java SE9. And a first step, I would even say an urgent step, would be to define the final module name of the Jakarta EE API. It's very important to define them as soon as possible, because as they will be public, we have to know in advance the name. This is technically easy. You just have to define an automatic variable name in the manifest.mf file. So this is an easy step. The second step will be more difficult, because it will require to define explicit modules with a proper module info declaring dependencies, exported package, and so on. So I guess that this will happen in the middle of next year. This is my expectation. And we also need a modular application server. Clearly today, just enough runtime is the new norm. We do not want a bloated heavyweight application server anymore. In that matter, IBM has done a great job. I wouldn't offend anyone, I think, by saying that WebSphere was the incarnation of the heavyweight application server. But IBM has made this revolution, and OpenLiberty is a totally different beast. In fact, the server is fully configurable. You define the feature you need. It can be MicroProfile or Java-E. So you can configure your server easily, either in a coarse-grained manner on the left or a thin-grained manner on the right, which is better. And even better, there is a Liberty Maven plugin which enables you to deploy to the package and deploy your application either at the thinware or a fat jar, a self-runnable fat jar. So this is a deployment decision, which is very good. So I know that Red Hat, Tommy Tribe, Payara have also done an excellent job in terms of modularization of the application server, but I think that the example of IBM is emblematic. The other concern I have in mind is related to the new Java SE release cadence. As you may know, Oracle has decided to totally revisit the release cadence of the Java SE platform with two feature releases per year, planned in March and September. The current one is Java SE 10, and one LTS release every 3 years. The next and very first one will be based on Java SE 11 in September. In fact, feature releases are intended to bring innovation, but they are not production ready. Their support will be limited to 6 months with no overlap. It's clearly not usable in production. In contrast, long-term support will bring stability in production, but will require commercial support. Gone are the time of long-term free Java support. So this is a challenge for the Java ecosystem as a whole, and in particular for Jakarta-E. So my vision is that in cruise mode, one Jakarta-E version, major version per year, based on the current LTS, would be a good fit. Because I think that Jakarta-E is for production. Clearly, it's for real-life project, it's for production, we need support. And I think that we don't list the very latest innovation at the Java SE level. So this is my vision. There are plenty of other challenges. They are all identified and widely discussed in the community. You can follow the different mailing lists. There are discussions about need for new profiles. For instance, do we need new profile, container awareness, many, many things. There is currently a lot of buzz on service mesh. My personal question, is it a new kind of ESB? I don't know. I have to watch that. So many other challenges. To summarize my talk, Java E is dead, but this is not the end of the story. It has a promising follow-up with Jakarta E. A vendor-neutral open specification really makes sense today, which was not totally the case with the GCP, because it was controlled by a commercial company The IP was the ownership of the specification leader. So vendor neutral open specification solves all data space, all that aspects. The Eclipse Foundation is the place to be to make that happen. To be honest, I didn't know a lot the Eclipse Foundation 6 months ago. I discovered it with Jakarta EE. MicroProfile has paved the way. In fact, MicroProfile has paved the way in two manners, both by being a demonstrator of how could work Jakarta EE, and also by bringing all cloud native features we need for Jakarta EE. So my bet is that Jakarta EE is there for another 20 years. But the next 2 years will be decisive. And I think that each contribution, even modest, can make the difference. So as a user of the technology, what can you do? First, stay tuned. You can visit the official Jakarta EE website. You can subscribe to the newsletter. You can follow it on Twitter. There are plenty of interesting information every day. It takes a lot of time, but it's interesting. You can become a Java EE guardian. I've done it. It has been an interesting experience. You can already start learning Java EE 8 and MicroProfile. You can increase your knowledge right now. There are tutorials, there are good examples. Especially, I invite you to follow Adam Bean and Sebastian Dashner, who are excellent teachers in that matter. And then after, you will be able to test. I think it will be important to test Glassfish 5.1, Glassfish 5.2 to provide feedback and also to feel concerned. So that's it for my presentation. Thank you.